the delivery time. So what do you have to do? You have to think, okay, you can order the right amount so the customer gets his items earlier, like Amazon Prime or stuff like that. But we're talking about 100,000, 200,000 items in this mail order company. We've got seasonality, the delivery time of goods does vary, but we are only getting an estimate from our customer that's for about 4 days from order to delivery. And well, there are a lot of, you see a lot of items, we've got a lot of slow selling goods that's quite hard to predict. And we've got also returns from the customers. So if you order something, you have to keep in mind, okay, I'm ordering, but I'm getting all the stuff back with some delay, about 1, 2, 3 weeks, depends on your product group. That's one case. So the other one is retail. Let's imagine a supermarket where if you got some amount of goods which is sold every day, let's say meat, milk, stuff like that, and well, you have to order the correct amount to minimize out of stock situations. Out of stock means your shelf is empty, and you have to handle as well as the excess, the surplus of goods in the evening, because we're dealing here sometimes with expiry dates. We've got weather, we've got seasonality, we've got special events like a soccer championship. We take care of everything. And we're talking about some hundred items in some hundred locations. So you've got a multiplication here. In the mail order example, you don't have locations. It's only one location. And here you've got, usually you've got fast moving goods here, because milk and bread and stuff like that, it's sold in amounts about 100 per store. Okay, so what is the essence of this? Okay, you have to you have to know the demand and stocks for certain periods of time in advance, and you have to know the frequency of orders. So, well, order the right amount of items considering the conditions, the boundary conditions. You have to calculate the correct amount of an order. So, well. Well, what do we need in a framework? Well, my talk covers more or less the prediction, simulation, replenishment module, and the testing. Everything else is necessary, but I had no time to really put it into the framework. Input-output is usually a big deal. We are dealing with companies, they have to bring the data to us. Sometimes it's corrupt, sometimes we've got problems with defining interfaces, and also output interfaces are quite difficult sometimes. And well, I just cook it down to CSV files, so it's no database and nothing else and nothing in it, just CSV files. I will talk about predictions, but only very, very low-level predictions like moving average or rolling mean. And in the replenishment, I will make some assumptions, so the calculation is easy and you can follow the formula. Well, and testing, I will talk some minutes about PyTest. And, well, I've written some unit tests for my functions I use in the framework. Well, plotting, logging, documentation, deployment, reporting, and monitoring is also very, very important. So you keep in mind, if you have this list and you think about it, then you've got, well, a minimal set of for a framework. Okay, for predictions, well, we need to know tomorrow's demand or another period of time, let's say 2 days, 3 days in advance. And I prepared some easy model examples like take yesterday's sales, take the last week's sales of the same week, take, well, I left that out, rolling mean and moving average. You can use gradient boost or whatever you like from scikit-learn. The order calculation. Well, I make the assumptions, okay, we've got a stock count in the evening of zero, so we're throwing everything away each day, because it's easier to predict and make an order forecast for items that are thrown away each day, so I don't have to do a stock simulation, a complicated one. My demand interval is 1 day, so everything gets delivered after 1 day. Well, here I've shown, okay, you've got the stock, you know the stock in the evening it's zero. You will calculate an order for that. So you know, okay, my order is coming in tomorrow, and I've got a demand to fulfill, so the customer's happy. And well, then the order is the demand tomorrow minus the stock in the evening, and the stock in the evening is zero. So the order is the demand. Very simple case. Okay, for reasons I'll explain a little bit later, I'm doing a simulation. So I predict the demand for each day on a test sample. So I have two cases, take yesterday's demand, or I calculate the rolling mean of the last 5 days. And then I calculate an order for a given strategy. For example, take the expectation value of your prediction, or more complicated, take a quantile of an assumed probability density. So let's say, usually, you can assume that goods are sold like in a Poisson distribution or something a bit more difficult, gamma Poisson distribution, and you can calculate this distribution from an expectation value you forecast, and then take a quantile of this assumed probability density. Okay, let's switch to a notebook. No, where is it? Okay. I've got some simulated data, where there's a simple data generator available in the repository you can download. It produces data, a time series with a Poisson distribution between 1 and 10. You can put in a number of items. Well, I took about 100 items. And, well, let's see. It's coming out. So I'm plotting one product. So that's the whole time series in a histogram, where you see, okay, we've got some very, very low number of zero sales. Then you've got about 40 sales of one, and so on. And well, you see the mean is about 4 here. So that's a Poisson distribution with a mean of 4, I suppose. And I can plot a time series of this product. It looks like that. Well, here you see I simulated a time series from 2014 till end of May of 2015, and you can see, well, the sales are fluctuating between 4 and 10, more or less. And you can plot also the sum of all sales of all products. So I've got about 100 products, and the mean is about 5, so, well, you see some Poisson fluctuations each day. And I can plot the mean for each product. So my product ID goes from 1 to 100, and you see, okay, each one has a mean between 0 and 10. Okay, let's go back to the talk. Okay, well, I've written some demo, some simulation, where you can do some different strategies like order 1, order 10, order the expectation value, order the quantile, take different predictions. And I can show you in a shell. Take some time. So the simulation will take about 30 seconds, and I'm giving it a config file. That's Windows. And we can have a look in this config. It's moving average, and I give it a name. Well, the ID is the output name, more or less, here. And it will run, and we can have a look in the configuration file. Well, here I've got the configuration file I'm giving to the program, and well, it tells the program, okay, simulate quantiles from 10 to 99 in some steps, take the model simple prediction, window 0, okay, that's, I show you the code for the prediction, so window 0 means nothing here. You've got a start date and an end date for the simulation and the replenishment rule you want to use. So that's what I call strategy. Okay, let's see. We've got the simulation. We've got the simulation code, so it's more or less reading in data frame, takes some arguments, and evaluates a prediction function and gives the arguments to the prediction function and does the replenishment and calculates what's too much and what's missing and writes it back. So you got a rate as a result of this calculation for each product and each day. Okay, and the prediction is in here. Well, I took right now, I took the simple prediction. That's just a shifted, well, I've got sales in my data frame and it shifted by 0 days. Because the shift value is also 0 I'm putting in. And that means, okay, I'm at the evening and I know, okay, I have nothing in stock, but I know the last sale, for example, 5 for this product. So my guess for an order expectation value is 5 for tomorrow. Okay, so it did run, and we got some, called it ABMR here, it's 1441, yeah. I got a result, we can have a look, and it's, yeah. And, well, we've got the index, then surplus means, okay, how many items did I have sold, and what's left in my stock, and it can be bigger than one, that means I've ordered more than I sold. It's bad. I've got an out of stock rate. That means, okay, how many days has this item been out of stock? And it's the mean of all items. So for low quantiles, it's 0.8 here, and it's getting, for bigger quantiles, it's getting quite slow. So you're ordering a lot, and but you've got a lot of leftovers. So, well, you can do it for every of those combination prediction replenishment, and you're getting curves like that. So you've seen the output, and well, here I wrote down the definition of excess rate and out of stock rate, so surplus amount versus sold amount, and item days out of stock versus all items times days combinations. And now you're getting a working curve, and depends on the what the customer does want. Well, let's think, okay, I simulated here some expectation values that would be the usual way, okay, we are ordering what has been sold yesterday, then you're getting a value about, well, out of stock rate about 50% and 25% excess rate. But we can do better. We can take the rolling mean, for example, with a window of 5, and you see this yellowish curve, I hope you can see it, and you're getting at the same out of stock rate for about 40%, you get about 18% excess rate. So this strategy would benefit, your customer would benefit about 6% points lower, lower surplus amount. You can choose the working point for your replenishment solution, you can put it in the config file, and well, you get a replenishment. Okay, I did this with some parallelization because I didn't write it in a very optimized way. So I thought, okay, I can parallelize it so it's getting a little bit faster, and it's quite easy if you use multiprocessing standard library of Python. And well, I've got 4 cores on this laptop, and well, and the result is map of function. The function is the simulation wrapper, and I put in a list of values. The list of values are my quantiles. So I parallelize each job is calculated for one quantile, given one given quantile. And our projects of this mail order company, we're using Redis for calculating it on multiple hosts, because we are dealing here with, well, let's say, so 650,000 products we have to simulate for about 25 quantiles and over time period of 60 days. So it takes about 1 hour with 90 CPUs, and the code is a little bit more complicated and it's a little bit optimized for speed. Okay, testing. Well, you've seen I've got some functions in my code. I've seen the predict functions here, three functions. I've got in the simulation, I've got as well some functions. Where is it? Here I've got the simulation per quantile, and I've written some tests, and the tests are in tests. It's just very simple, assuming some data frame, putting in the data frame the function, and testing the result. And I'm using PyTest. Just type PyTest, and it looks for all the test files in your directory. I've got three. I've got 10 unit tests, and they're all passed. And I can put in, I'm using also PyTest coverage. So I can say, OK, give me those two directories and test for how many percent are covered. I think it's two. So it's written out an HTML file. Can have a look into it. HTML, cuff, and the index. Okay, so I've tested those two directories, the replenishment and simulation directory, and you can see the test coverage is 99%. Sounds good. And we can have a look into it, and okay, you've got the code and everything's green, so this function has been tested. Well, usually you don't test every case, but you can see you can test every function here. So stock simulation is tested. Well, in the init files it's just for importing, there's nothing in it. And the simulation is tested. Well, I didn't test the wrapper. You can see it here, it's red. This function is not tested, so I've got 96% of coverage. One missing, 25 run. Okay. And I'm testing also my config. Well, I'm using the voluptuous package on PyPI server. It's quite nice if you want to test config files. So, as I showed you earlier, I've got some config files, like the simulation with the prediction, and I've written a validator. Well, I pass this config first, it's in YAML, and then I'm testing it in the config, the validator, and right here it's, okay, I'm loading in, importing, from voluptuous, I'm importing scheme, objects, and so on. Look into documentation, it's quite nicely documented. And here I'm defining some lists, so a list of ints for testing my quantiles. And then I've got some check for dates, and then here it's a scheme. And I'm testing for the scheme, so the quantiles have to be in between 1 and 100. Okay, 100 is, I think it's not in the range, so it's 1 to 99. And model has to be a string, the window has to be int. Okay, this tool has to be a date with a certain format, year, month, day, and an input file with a string. Okay, let's test it. Ah, I hate it, Windows. okay, I can put YAML in it. For example, simulation, and type is simulation. And nothing happens, okay, everything's fine, so let's change it. Let's go back. No. No, PyCharm. Let's go to simulation, and I put in a string into the window. Save it. And run it again, and I got an invalid message. You can put it nicer, you got a nice exception. Okay, here extra keys not allowed in data prediction start date. Oh, why in start date? It's actually, it's before that. It's interesting. Sometimes I don't know what's happening with it. And now it's working. No? Did I? Ah, yeah, okay. That was an error. Yeah, now it's in the window. Okay, so. Okay, that was the config testing and the PyTest. Well, replenishment. Well, it's nearly the same code I use in the simulation. It's just a little bit different. You don't scan over a range of quantiles. You define your working point from the nice curve I showed you earlier. So here I take a 60% quantile. So I hope I'll get an out of stock rate of 33% and excess rate of 23%. So that means in 66%, so that's 2 of 3 days, the customer stands in front of an empty shelf. And the customer, well, the grocery store or something like that has to throw away about 23% what he's selling. So that's quite high, but I'm throwing everything away each evening. So that's really a worst case scenario. Usually you've got, in grocery stores, you've expiry dates of a week or 2 or 3 days, depend on the product. So the code is nearly the same. Let's go into the code. Replenishment. And it's just called order. I've got a model, I've got a prediction model, I've got this replenishment rule, same as in simulation, and then I'm doing order. And it's predictions, and I apply a lambda on it. But first I'm calculating a prediction, and then I've got the prediction, which is my demand for the next day, and I apply a lambda on it, and it's a replenishment function. And the replenishment function is defined in the replenishment rules. So I can give it into the config, and let's say, okay, order 1, order 10, and what's not good. Order, let's say, the expectation value of this prediction. Well, it's more like a prediction. And here it's the standard replenishment I'm doing, so I'm taking Poisson distribution, put in the quantile, and the prognosis, the forecast for the sales, as a lambda. Okay. And well, the order then is just sales minus stock, stock 0, and open orders is also 0. Because I'm just ordering for tomorrow, so there's no incoming goods. And then I'm doing a stochastic rounding. And that's all. So let's run it. What's the validator? Okay, so the input file is config replenishment, and order day is, for example, 2015. So it's just an order for one day, let's say, and put it out to test. Okay, so it takes about 5 seconds to run this. 4.3 seconds. So I just calculated the orders, and usually you're putting that into a database, and then you're putting it on an output file, and the customer retrieves the output file and does an automatic order. So that's the optimization. Let's have a look at the order generated. Okay, it's called test. It's just a simple CSV file with a date, a product ID, sales versus the truth. Usually you don't know that, and prediction and the order. So my prediction is 6, and I'm ordering, I think, the 70% quantile, so it's a little bit higher because it's above the mean. And you see, okay, you've got some orders. You can have a look into a file I prepared earlier in a notebook. And it's orders. Read in the order and plot everything into a histogram. You see the order is distributed between 0 and 17. And the prediction is a little bit lower because I said it's the average. And what's my average order for this day? It's 6. So my mean is I'm ordering about 6 items per order, the amount of 6 per item per day. And well, my randomly simulated data has more or less an average of 5, so it's not so bad. Okay, let's go back. Okay. So what is missing? I didn't talk about logging, but I think it's quite important if you've got a big project, a lot of stuff going on, you want to analyze what's wrong, because the system is usually quite stable, but sometimes something happens, like a customer sends corrupt data, or you've got memory leak which you didn't expect to, and stuff like that, and then you need a logger. So everything's covered in the standard library of logging. You can use Graylog and everything, something like that, to evaluate the logging data. And then reporting, monitoring, plotting is very important because, well, data in CSV files is nice, but I am a visually guy, so it's just I want to see some plots, some data visualized. And you can use different tools like Matplotlib and on top on it Seaburn for doing some simple regressions, or you use Bouquet. Well, we had some talks around here. Okay, documentation is also important. I just wrote down which parameters go into functions as a comment, but you can, for good documentation, you can use Sphinx. And also, if you have got some productive system or testing system, you want to deploy code. At the moment, I'm using Ansible. There were some nice talks around here, and you can just look into the web pages. While putting it all together, what do we have? We've got a prediction module, a replenishment rules put together to a replenishment module, and we've got a stock simulation, which is very, very simple, but it's easy to enhance it, and we've got a simulation. And what we also would nice to have is documentation, logging, monitoring, tests, and configuration. We have, I already showed you that. And deployment and reporting. Reporting means the customer wants a daily report of how many items were out of stock, how much was left over in the shelves, what's the average amount of items ordered, stuff like that. Because usually, if you send him the data and he puts it into the database, sometimes it's very hard for our customers to get the data out. So reporting plays a big role in other companies. We don't like too much reporting stuff because it takes time. You have to prepare data, and usually we have to look at the data ourselves because it's as a cross-check with our customers. So the customer says, okay, the access rate was 12%, and we say, okay, we've got monitoring reporting. No, we just made a plot. It's 8.5%, you're doing something wrong, and you always have to cross-check with your customer, because in the real world, while simulating is nice, but and double-checking is even better. Okay, Well, what we have, we've got a simple replenishment framework with a basic solution for an automated order forecast system in the case of everyday order and everyday replenishment. And it's quite simple to put this together with the tools, Python, standard library, pandas, and so on. And NumPy gives to you. And well, what's the lesson? Well, writing Python code is easy, and you can use it in everyday life, and you can use it to produce real value for companies, because throwing away goods or shortening delivery times is very good for our customers, and they are quite thankful for us that we are applying them with good prognosis and good forecasts. So thank you, and visit us at our Blue Yonder booth. I see you soon, and if you like to ask some questions, feel free.